HarperCollins presents All the Dangerous Things by Stacy Willingham, read by Karissa Vacker.
Sleep, those little slices of death, how I loathe them. Anonymous. Prologue. Today is day 364. 364 days since my last night of sleep. That's almost 9,000 hours. 524,000 minutes. 31 million seconds. Or, if you want to go in the opposite direction, 52 weeks. 12 months. One whole year without a single night of rest. 1 year of stumbling through life in a semi-conscious dream state. 1 year of opening my eyes to find myself in another room, another building, without any recollection of when I got there or how I arrived. 1 year of sleeping pills and eye drops and chugging caffeine by the quartful, of jittery fingers and drooping eyelids, of becoming intimately familiar with the night. 1 whole year since my mason was taken from me, and still, I'm no closer to the truth. Chapter 1. Now.
Isabel, you're on in 5.
My pupils are drilling into a spot in the carpet. A spot with no significance, really, other than the fact that my eyes seem to like it here. My surroundings grow fuzzy as the spot, my spot, gets sharper, clearer. Like tunnel vision.
Isabel.
I wish I could always have tunnel vision. The ability to selectively focus on one single thing at a time. Turn everything else into static, white noise.
Isabel.
Snap, snap. There's a hand in front of my face now, waving, fingers clicking. It makes me blink.
Earth to Isabel.
Sorry. I say, shaking my head, as if the motion could somehow clear the fog like windshield wipers swiping at rain. I blink a few more times before trying to find the spot again, but it's gone now. I know it's gone. It's melted back into the carpet, into oblivion, the way I wish I could. Sorry, yeah, on in 5. I lift my arm and take a sip of my styrofoam cup of coffee. Strong, black. Squeaky when my chapped lips stick to the rim. I used to savor the taste of that daily morning cup. I lived for the smell of it wafting through my kitchen, the warmth of a mug pushed against my fingers, cold and stiff from standing on the back porch, watching the sun come up with morning dew beating on my skin. But it wasn't the coffee I needed, I know that now. It was the routine, the familiarity, comfort in a cup. Like those dehydrated noodles you splash faucet water onto before popping them into the microwave and calling it a meal. But I don't care about that anymore. Comfort, routine. Comfort is a luxury I can no longer afford, and routine, well, I haven't had that in a long time either. Now I just need the caffeine. I need to stay awake.
On in 2?
I look up at the man standing before me, clipboard resting against his hip. I nod, down the rest of the coffee, and savor the bitter pinch in my jaw. It tastes like shit, but I don't care. It's doing its job. I dig my hand into my purse and pull out a bottle of eye drops, redness relief, and squirt 3 beads of liquid into each eye with expert precision. I guess this is my routine now. Then I stand up, run my hands over the front of my pants, and slap my palms against my thighs, signaling that I'm ready.
If you'll follow me.
I hold out my arm, gesturing for the man to lead the way. And then I follow. I follow him out the door and through a dim hallway, the fluorescent lights buzzing in my ear like an electric chair humming to life. I follow him through another door, the gentle roar of applause erupting as soon as it opens and we step inside. I walk past him, to the edge of the stage, and stand behind a black curtain, the audience just barely obscured from view. This is a big one. The biggest I've done. I look down at my hands, where I used to hold note cards with talking points scribbled in pencil. Little bulleted instructions reminding me what to say, what not to say. How to order the story like I'm following a recipe, meticulous and careful, sprinkling the details in just right. But I don't need those anymore. I've done this too many times. Besides, there's nothing new to say.
And now we are ready to bring out the person I know you're all here to see.
I watch the man speaking on stage, 10 feet away, his voice booming over the loudspeakers. It's everywhere, it seems. In front of me, behind me, inside me somehow. Somewhere deep in my chest. The audience cheers again, and I clear my throat, remind myself why I'm here.
Ladies and gentlemen of True Crime Con, it is my honor to present to you our keynote speaker, Isabel Drake.
I step into the light, walking with purpose toward the host as he signals me on stage. The crowd continues to yell, some of them standing, clapping, the beady little eyes of their iPhones pointed in my direction, taking me in, unblinking. I turn toward the audience, squinting at their silhouettes. My eyes adjust a bit, and I wave, smiling weakly before coming to a halt in the center. The host hands me a microphone, and I grab it, nodding. "Thank you," I say, my voice sounding like an echo. "Thank you all for coming out this weekend. What an incredible bunch of speakers." The crowd erupts again, and I take the free seconds to scan the sea of faces the way I always do. It's women, mostly. It's always women. Older women in groups of 5 or 10, relishing this annual tradition, the ability to break away from their lives and their responsibilities and drown themselves in fantasy. Younger women, 20-somethings, looking skittish and a little embarrassed, like they've just been caught looking at porn. But there are men, too. Husbands and boyfriends who were dragged along against their will, the kind with wire-rimmed glasses and peach-fuzz beards and elbows that protrude awkwardly from their arms like knobby tree branches. There are the loners in the corner, the ones whose eyes linger just long enough to make you uncomfortable, and the police officers perusing the aisles, stifling yawns. And then I notice the clothing. One girl wears a graphic tee that says, "Red Wine and True Crime," the tee in the shape of a gun. Another sports a white shirt sprayed with specks of red. It's supposed to mimic blood, I assume. Then I see a woman wearing a t-shirt that says, "Bundy, Dahmer, Gacy, Berkowitz." I remember walking past it earlier in the gift shop. It was clipped tight against a mannequin, being advertised in the same way they advertised overpriced band t-shirts in the merchandise tents at concerts. Memorabilia for rabid fans. I feel the familiar swell of bile in my throat, warm and sharp, and force myself to look away. As I'm sure you all know, my name is Isabel Drake, and my son, Mason, was kidnapped 1 year ago, I say. His case is still unsolved. Chairs squeak. Throats are cleared. A mousy woman in the front row is shaking her head gently, tears in her eyes. She is loving this right now. I know she is. It's like she's watching her favorite movie, mindlessly snacking on popcorn as her lips move gently, reciting every word. She's heard my speech already. She knows what happened. She knows, but she still can't get enough. None of them can. The murderers on the t-shirts are the villains, the uniformed men in back, the heroes. Mason is the victim. And I'm not really sure where that leaves me. The lone survivor, maybe. The one with a story to tell. Chapter 2. I settle into my seat, the aisle seat. Generally, I prefer the window, something to lean up against and close my eyes. Not to sleep, exactly, but to drift away for a while. Microsleeping is what my doctor calls it. We've all seen it before, especially on airplanes. The twitching eyelids, the bobbing head. 2 to 20 seconds of unconsciousness before your neck snaps back up with astonishing force like a cocking shotgun, ready to go. I look at the seat to my right. Empty. I hope it stays open. Takeoff is in 20 minutes. The gate is about to close. And when it does, I can move over. I can close my eyes. I can try, as I've been trying for the last year, to finally get some rest. Excuse me? I jump, looking at the flight attendant before me. She's tapping the back of my seat, disapproval in her eyes. We're going to need you to make sure your seat back is in the upright and locked position. I look back down, push the little silver button on my armrest, and feel my back begin to bend forward at an acute angle, my stomach folding in on itself. The attendant begins to walk away, pushing overhead compartments closed as she goes, when I reach out my arm and stop her. Can I bother you for a soda water? We'll begin beverage service as soon as we take off. Please, I add, grabbing her arm harder as she starts to step away. If you wouldn't mind, I've been talking all day. I touch my throat for emphasis, and she looks down the aisle at the other passengers squirming uncomfortably, adjusting their seatbelts, digging through backpacks for headphones. Fine, she says, her lips pinched tight. Just a moment. I smile, nod, and ease back into my seat before looking around the plane at the other passengers I'll be sharing circulated air with for the next 4 hours as we make our way from Los Angeles to Atlanta. It's a game I play, trying to imagine what they're doing here, what life circumstances brought them to this exact moment with this exact group of strangers. I wonder what they've been doing or what they plan to do. Are they going somewhere or are they making their way home? My eyes land first on a child sitting alone, giant headphones swallowing his ears. I imagine he's a product of divorce, spending one weekend every month getting shuttled from one side of the country to the other like cargo. I feel myself starting to imagine how Mason might have looked at that age, how his green eyes could have morphed even greener, two twin emeralds twinkling like his father's, or how his baby smooth skin might have taken on the olive tone of my own. A natural tan without having to step foot in the sun. I swallow hard and force myself to turn away, twisting to the left and taking in the others. There are older men on laptops and women with books, teenagers on cell phones slouched low in their seats, gangly knees knocking into the seat backs in front of them. Some of these people are traveling to weddings or funerals. Some are embarking on business trips or clandestine getaways paid for in cash. And some of these people have secrets. All of them do, really. But some of them have the real ones, the messy ones, the deep, dark, shadowy ones that lurk just beneath the skin, traveling through their veins and spreading like a sickness, dividing, multiplying, then dividing again. I wonder which ones they are, the ones with the kinds of secrets that touch every organ and render them rotten. The kinds of secrets that will eat them alive from the inside out. Nobody in here could possibly imagine what I've just spent my day doing, recounting the most painful moment of my life for the enjoyment of strangers. I have a speech now, a speech that I recite with absolute detachment, engineered in just the right way. Sound bites that I know will read well when ripped from my mouth and printed inside newspapers, and manufactured moments of silence when I want a point to sink in. Warm memories of Mason to break up a particularly tense scene when I'm sensing the need for some comedic relief. Just as I'm going deep into his disappearance, the open window I had discovered in his bedroom letting in a warm, damp breeze, the tiny mobile situated above his bed, little stuffed dinosaurs dancing gently in the wind, I stop, swallow. Then I recite the story of how Mason had just started talking, how he pronounced T-Rex Tyrannosnorius, and how every time he pointed at the little creatures above his bed, my husband would break out into exaggerated snores, sending him into a fit of giggles before drifting off himself. And then the audience would allow themselves to smile, maybe even laugh. There would be a visible release in their shoulders. Their bodies would settle into their chairs again, a collectively held breath released. Because that's the thing with the audience, the thing I learned long ago. They don't want to get too uncomfortable. They don't want to actually live through what I've lived through, every ugly moment. They just want a taste. They want enough for their curiosity to be satiated. But if it gets too bitter or too salty or too real, they'll smack their lips and leave dissatisfied. And we don't want that. The truth is, people love violence, from a distance, that is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.